إن الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء وعلى آله وأصحابه ومن والاه. أما بعد، الله سبحانه وتعالى said وهو معكم أينما كنتم. الله سبحانه وتعالى said He is with you wherever you might be, wherever you are. وَهُوَ مَعَكُمْ أَيْنَمَا كُنْتُمْ. My brothers and sisters, I remind myself and you to reflect on this ayah, to think about this ayah. Because the kalam of Allah Jalla wa Ala came not just to be recited for sawab, not just to be recited in a nice tone so that people enjoy the recitation just like they enjoy somebody singing a nasheed. That's not the purpose for the kalam. Alhamdulillah, to recite the kalam in a good manner, this is part of the adab of the Quran. So one must do it. But that is not the purpose for which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed His kalam. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed His kalam so that we might reflect on it, so that we might gain strength from it, so that we might then practice it in our lives. And that is the reason why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, and this ayah did not come for the Muslims, it came for the people who denied the kalam. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, أَفَلَا يَتَدَبَّرُونَ الْقُرْآنَ أَمْ عَلَىٰ قُلُوبٍ أَقْفَالُهَا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, do they not reflect on this kalam of Allah? Do they not make tadabbur on the kalam? Do they not think about this kalam? Or is it that their hearts are sealed? Do they have kufl? Do they have locks on their hearts? So I remind myself and you, let us reflect on this. What is the meaning when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَهُوَ مَعَكُمْ أَيْنَمَا كُنْتُمْ. He is with you wherever you are. I reflect on this, and I invite you to reflect on this, because the issue is not whether Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is with us or not, because He said He is with us. The issue is, are we aware of the ma'iyyat of Allah? Are we aware that Allah is with us? The bottom line is not whether Allah is with us or not, because that's not a matter of question. There is no doubt about this. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala Himself said, wa ma'akum aina ma kuntum. So what is the doubt? The question is, am I aware of this? Am I aware that Allah is with me? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Surah Al-Alaq, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, أَلَمْ يَعْلَمْ بِأَنَّ اللَّهَ يَرَى. This ayah came for Abu Jahl, but it's an ayah which we need to reflect on ourselves. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, أَلَمْ يَعْلَمْ بِأَنَّ اللَّهَ يَرَى. Allah said, is he not aware that Allah is watching? Is he not aware that Allah is watching? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is سَمِعٌ basir. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one who sees, is the one who hears, and the one who sees. Sami'ul basir. Wa asirru qawlakum wa ijharu bihi innahu alimun bi dhati sudur. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, whether you say it loudly, you don't say it loudly, whatever, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is aware of what is inside your heart. Wa in tubdu ma fi anfusikum aw tukhfuhu yuhasibkum bihi Allah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is aware. The question is, am I aware? Are you aware that Allah is watching? Am I and are you aware that Allah is with us? Now, what is the benefit of being aware that Allah is with us? What is the benefit of the istihzar of this ayah of the kalam of Allah, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَهُوَ مَعَكُمْ أَيْنَمَا كُنْتُمْ. What's the benefit of this? There are two major benefits. The number one benefit of this is that this awareness will keep us protected from any kind of sin. Because how is it possible that we can commit a sin when we are aware that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is with me? It's not possible. The biggest benefit of this is that it keeps us protected from sin. Number one. Number two, second benefit of being aware of وَهُوَ مَعَكُمْ أَيْنَمَا كُنْتُمْ is that it gives us freedom from fear. Complete freedom from fear. How can a person who is aware that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is with him, he is aware of this. A person who is aware Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is with me, how can this person be afraid of anything in creation? Anything in creation. How can he be afraid in any situation in life? How can any form of anxiety and depression ever touch a person who is aware of وَهُوَ مَعَكُمْ أَيْنَمَا كُنْتُمْ. Now how do we bring about this awareness? How does this awareness come about? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, قَدْ أَفْلَحَ مَنْ تَزَكَّى. They have succeeded, those who have purified themselves. So the first condition of being aware of Allah Jalla wa Ala, of His ma'iyyat, of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala being with us, is purification of ourselves. What is the meaning of purification of ourselves? There is an external purification, which is our ghusl and our wudu and the being careful about our clothes and our surroundings and so on. Part of the external purification is also with respect to our akhlaq, of how do we present ourselves in the world. And then there is another level of purification. And that level of purification is the purification of the heart. Tazkiyatun nafs. Tazkiyatun nafs. Purification of the heart. Purifying the heart and cleaning it of every negative emotion. Purifying the heart and cleaning it of everything which is disobedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Cleaning the heart of every form of masiyah. Cleaning the heart of every form of the desire for sin. Imam Al-Ghazali rahmatullah alayhi said, perish the thought itself. He said, when the thought comes, kill it. Don't dwell on the thought. Kill it. Destroy the thought. Because if you do not do that, the thought will lead to the word and the word will lead to the action. The thought will lead to the word and the word will lead to the action. Imam Ghazali said, don't even keep the thought in your mind. So purifying the heart of all negative thoughts, all thoughts towards evil, all thoughts towards sin. Number two, purifying the heart of all signs of rebellion, of all signs of rebellion against Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Any thought that comes, when there is the hukum of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala before us, when there is a sunnah of Muhammadur Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam before us, and our nafs or our friends or anybody in creation tells us something which is different from this, which is against it, then what do you do with that? Kill it. Destroy it. Completely. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, أَرَأَيْتَ مَنِ اتَّخَذَ إِلَٰهَهُ هَوَى. In Surah Al-Furqan, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, have you not seen them? Those who have taken their hawa, their desires as their ilah, as their God, they worship their desires. They commit shirk. They commit shirk. To do something according to my desire, when there is a hukum of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which is the opposite of that, is to commit shirk. This is shirk. This is shirk just like going and bowing to a qabr or bowing to a statue or something. In my heart, I'm committing shirk. Why? Because I have given precedence to some desire of my heart over the hukum of Allah Jalla wa Ala. أَرَأَيْتَ مَنِ اتَّخَذَ إِلَٰهَهُ هَوَى. So cleaning the heart of all forms of rebellion against Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. cleaning the heart of hatred. I will not listen to my brother because I don't like his face. I don't like him. I hate him. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned this in the Quran with regard to the treatment of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, you know that what he is saying is right, but you don't want to accept it because you don't like him. Hatred. Greed. Clean the heart of greed. The heart, clean the heart of desire for the things of this dunya. I'm not saying leave the things of this dunya. Allah did not send us into this dunya to leave the dunya. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent us into this dunya to use the dunya. I'm wearing a pair of Bali shoes. And I'm wearing this cap. For the price of the shoes, I can buy maybe 1,000 caps. So what should I do? Take off my cap and put the shoe on my head? Because the shoe is so expensive. Why should I wear it on my foot? I should wear it on my head. Yes? That is the meaning of the desire for this dunya. The shoe is meant to be used. It's not meant for me. There is no need for me to walk barefoot and say I will not wear shoes anymore. That is nonsense. The shoe is meant to be worn on the foot, not on the head. To have the desire for the things of the dunya in the heart is like wearing the shoe on your head. By all means, do not do israf. But other than israf, by all means, live well, wear well, eat well, drive well. No problem. Alhamdulillah. Make shukr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When you sit in your car and you turn on the engine and you have a beautiful car, say Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen, Yalla, you gave this to me. I could have been on a bicycle at this time. I could have been on an auto rickshaw at this time or something. But Alhamdulillah, you gave me this beautiful car. Alhamdulillah, Ya Rab. Awareness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Clean the heart of greed. Why? Because greed leads to bukhl. Greed leads to stinginess. Why are we saying clean the heart of these things? Because every one of these leads to something, to an action which is haram. Greed leads to bukhl. Bukhl will prevent you from spending in the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Envy. Clean the heart of envy and jealousy. And you know why? Because envy and jealousy will lead you to doing ghiba, which is like eating the flesh of your dead brother. Haram. Who do we make ghiba about? People we are envious of. People we are jealous of. Every one of these things in the heart leads to some action which is haram. It will either lead to directly to shirk, or it will lead to kufr, or it will lead to some action, some guna kabira, some action which is haram. And that's why, what do we need to do? Take it out from here. Clean the heart. Tazkiyatun nafs. So I told you, how do we develop awareness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the ma'iyat of Allah? By doing two things. And the first of them is, Tazkiyatun nafs. The second one is kasratu sujood. Increase the amount of number of sujood we do. Increase the sajda we do. Increase our ibadat. We get close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala not by reading books but by standing in tahajjud. I'm not against reading books. Of course, we have to read books. But that's not the way to get close to Allah. You do not get close to Allah by studying usul of deen. You get close to Allah by understanding the asal behind the usul. You get close to Allah by standing in tahajjud. It's not my fatwa. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said this. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم يا أيها المزمل قم الليل إلا قليلا نصفه أو انقص منه قليلا أو زد عليه ورتل القرآن ترتيلا إنا سنلقي عليك قولا ثقيلا إن ناشئة الليل هي أشد إن ناشئة الليل هي أشد وطئا وأقوى مقيلا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying to his Habib Muhammad Mustafa sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, it is the right of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that when his name is mentioned, that his ummatis send salat and salam on him. So recite durood. And the a'imma of Islam, they have said that it is wajib to recite the durood at least once in the majlis. And then whenever the name of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam comes, say sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. You don't have to say it aloud, but say it within yourself. Don't be stingy with sending salam on Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said in a hadith that the one who sends salat and salam on me, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sends salam on him 10 times. 10 times. So make it a habit continuously to keep on reciting durood, to keep on sending salat and salam on Muhammad Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So what is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala saying to his Habib sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? He is saying, get up, ya ayyuhal muzzammil. The one who's wrapped in and sleeping, get up. Qumil layl. Stand the whole night. Stand the whole night. Illa qalil, except a little bit. Nisfahu awin qusminu qalil awzid alay. Half the night, three quarters of the night, little more, little less. And do what? Tell us, what have you learnt? Sabak sunayye. Warattilil qur'ana tartila. Please reflect on the Quran. What is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala saying? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala saying, Sabak sunaye, we have sent you something, you learnt it now, recite back. Let us see what you have learnt. Warattil al-Qur'ana tartila. Recite the kalam of Allah to him. Hey. Do we have this awareness? وَهُوَ مَعَكُمْ أَيْنَ مَا كُنْتُمْ. He is with us wherever we are. Is he with us in salah? Is he with me in salah? Am I aware of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in my salah? If I'm not even aware of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in my salah, where I have made the clear intention of coming and standing before him, where I made preparation, I made wudu, and I made sure my clothes are good and so on, and I come and stand and I say, Allahu Akbar, and Allah is not with me. Ajib. What salah is this? What salah is this? May Allah accept our salah no matter what it is. But I am saying we have to work on this thing. We have to work on this thing. What we are doing is the appearance of salah. It is the acting of salah. It is not salah. It is not salah. It is the acting of salah. Because what is actually salah? What is salah? Who is the one who is the best qualified to describe what is salah? The one who said, Sallu kama ra'aytumuni usalli. Yes? Who is better qualified to describe what is salah than the one who said, Sallu kama ra'aytumuni usalli. Pray as you have seen me pray. And what did he say about salah? An ta'bud Allah ka annaka tara. Fa illam takun tara fa innahu yarak. Hey, this is salah. He said, pray. Al-Isan, in Hadith Jibreel. What did he say? He said, An ta'bud Allah ka annaka tara. To worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as if I can see him. As if you can see him. فَإِلَّمْ تَكُنْ تَرَى فَإِنَّهُ يَرَاكَ. And if you cannot see him, you know that he sees you. Awareness. وَهُوَ مَعَكُمْ أَيْنَمَا كُنْتُمْ. What is the purpose of salah? To bring this awareness about. And that is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala taught his Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam this. وَرَتِّلِ الْقُرْآنَ تَرْتِيلًا. إنا سنلقي عليك قولا ثقيلا. There is a lot of work to be done. We are going to send on you a very heavy duty, a very heavy kalam, a very heavy message. And for that, what to do? إِنَّ نَاشِيَةَ اللَّيْلِهِ أَشَدْ. Allah says, yes, we know it is difficult to stand in the night. We know it is أَشَدْ, very difficult. وَتْعَوْ وَأَقْوَ مُقِيلَ. But it is the best thing to understand the kalam of Allah and to develop discipline. What did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say about this salah in the night? تتجافى جنوبهم عن المضاجع يدعون ربهم خوفا وطمعا ومما رزقناهم ينفقون فلا تعلم نفس ما أخفي لهم من قرة عين جزاء بما كانوا يعملون. What did Allah say about this kalam, about this salah in the night? تتجافى جنوبهم عن المضاجع يدعون ربهم خوفا وطمعا. Hasan al-Basri wakes up in the night and he stands in salah, and before he starts his salah he says, oh my Rabb, he says, ya Rabbi, there is no one awake in the world except two, you and me. He said, even the stars have gone to sleep. ये अल्लाह के चाहने वालों की बात है भाई. Don't take the literal meaning of this and say when Hasan al-Basri, when he was saying this, after all the sun had already risen in Australia, so somebody was awake. La hawla wa la quwwata illa billah. People have this idiotic concept of, understand this deen. This is not meant for everything to take a literal meaning. No. ये तो अल्लाह से अल्लाह के चाहने वाले, अल्लाह से मोहब्बत करने वाले, दीज आर द पीपल हु लव्ड अल्लाह सुभानहू व तआला. ये बंदे की और उसके रब के बीच की बात है. व्हाई एम आई मेंशनिंग दिस? बिकॉज़ दिस इज पॉसिबल फॉर अस. या हाउ मेनी ऑफ अस टॉक टू अल्लाह? हाउ मेनी ऑफ अस टॉक टू अल्लाह? एंड इफ यू डोंट टॉक टू अल्लाह, व्हाई डोंट यू टॉक टू अल्लाह? अल्लाह सुभानहू व तआला इज समीउन बसीर. या Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala hears and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sees. So why don't you talk to Allah? I'm not saying only in salah, including in salah, but even outside salah. Why don't you talk to Allah? You know, I've reached an age now where I have to eat various all sorts of stuff. So there's a very small, and these doctors, they invent medicines for older people to eat, which are microscopic in size. If you're an old person, you should have a medicine which is like 4 feet long or something, you know, chop it up and. But they give you a tiny tablet like this. And every once in a while, this tablet will slip out of my hand and fall. And may Allah protect me from riya. I'm talking about what I do. I'm not saying this because I want you to follow me. I'm not worthy of following, please. But you know, when that tablet falls, I can't see it. So you know what I do? I say, ya Allah, I can't see it, but you can see it, so show it to me. And never once have I lost that tablet. No matter where it falls. I say, oh Allah, I can't see it, but you know where it is. Please show it to me. Talk to Allah. Talk to Allah. وَهُوَ مَعَكُمْ أَيْنَمَا كُنْتُمْ. Work on the salah, so we are aware of the ma'iyat of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You're standing before Allah. Oh Allah, there is only you and me. Kasratu sujood, doing more sajda. There is this great mistaken impression in the minds of people today that Islam means to study this book and 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 go to this course and that course. And the same person, alhamdulillah, nothing wrong with what they are doing, do attend every course in the world. But you ask the same person, do you pray tahajjud every day? I say no. And then you know what happens? The ilm becomes a hijab. The ilm prevents you from earning good deeds. Because now I have studied usul of fiqh. So therefore, when somebody says, do you pray tahajjud every day? He says, my brother, tahajjud is not fard. Tahajjud is only nafil. Aha. Tahajjud is nafil. Tahajjud is only nafil. If it is only nafil, then why did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mention tahajjud in the Quran? Not once, but several times. If it is only nafil, meaning that it's not important, then why did Allah say tatajafa junubhum anil madaji yaduna rabbahum khawfan wa tam'a? Imagine this. May Allah make our salah this. He stands up in the night and he's standing before his Rabb. For him there is no one except his Rabb. And what is his position? Bain al khawfi wa tam'a. Between the fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's anger and the hope of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's mercy. This is the position of the Muslim. To live his whole life. The salah is the tarbiyah for the rest of life. The salah is the tarbiyah for the rest of life. The whole life of the Muslim must be between these two points. The fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the hope for his mercy. This is the position of the Muslim. And that's why the salah is the tarbiyah. The iconic position of the salah is when do you know absolutely that a person is in salah? If a person is standing like this, can you be absolutely sure he is in salah? Maybe may not be, he's standing there. People stand for various reasons. If he is in ruku, maybe he is looking for something which fell down on the ground. We don't know, he is bending up. But what position when the person gets into it, this is salah. There's no reason on the face of the planet and in your life why you would put your face on the ground except for the glory and majesty of my Rabb. And that is the reason why the sajda is haram to anything other than Allah. The sajda is haram to anyone and anything other than Allah's Jalla wa Ala. Why? Because in the sajda the person is completely helpless. Totally helpless. It's the essence of ubudiyat. My face is on the ground, my hands are on the ground, my knees are on the ground, my feet are on the ground. I am even looking at the ground. I don't even know what's coming. If someone wants to chop my neck, they can do that without any problem. Because I can't even defend myself. I am in a completely helpless and undefensible position. And that is the reason why it is haram for the Muslim to put himself in that position before anyone other than Allah. Why the sajda? Because the sajda is the tarbiyat for the rest of life. For the Muslim, the sajda is what the position that he is in the whole of his life, not only in salah. His whole life is in sujood. Marana Yunus Patel, rahmatullah alayhi, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala fill his qabr with noor, famous quote of his, which many of you are aware of. He used to say the salah begins outside the masjid. He used to say the salah begins when you leave the masjid. What is the meaning of that? It means that in the salah you got the tarbiyah of how to live the rest of your life. And when you go out of the masjid, that is the tarbiyah you are going to follow in your life. وَهُوَ مَعَكُمْ أَيْنَمَا كُنْتُمْ. He is with you wherever you are. We looked at what is the meaning of that. We looked at how can we develop this. Now let us look at people who had this. There is a man standing in the court of the most powerful king that ever lived on the planet. The richest, the wealthiest dynasty that ever existed, whose tombs, the tomb that they built, is one of two structures which is visible from outer space. The great pyramid of Cheops, the Pharaonic dynasty of Egypt, the king of the upper and the lower kingdoms of the Nile, Ramesses the Fourth. I want you to put yourself, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent this kalam for us to understand, for us to put ourselves in that place. Think about that. What if the tomb of the Fir'aun is the great pyramid of Cheops, which is visible from outer space, what must the palace of that king have been like? What must have been the pomp and glory of that king in the palace? What must have been the state of the brocades and the silks? What must have been the state of the marbles and the gold? What must have been the state of the weapons and the shining armors? What must have been the state of the troops and the commanders and his nobility? And in all of that, in the middle of that is standing one man, a stick in his hand, a turban on his head, tall man, dark in complexion, big man, very powerfully built, big beard. And he stands there. And the Pharaoh, in his arrogance, he says to him, وَمَا رَبُّ الْعَالَمِينَ? Who is this رَبُّ الْعَالَمِينَ? And this man says, رَبِّ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ وَمَا بَيْنَهُمَا إِن كُنْتُم مُوقِنِينَ. He is the Rabb of the heavens and the earth and everything else in between. Think about that. Is he aware, Musa alayhi salam, is he aware of the pomp and glory of Pharaoh? Or is he aware of something else? What is he aware of? He is aware, he has looked at something and now he is blind to everything else. He can't see anything else. Wherever he looks, he only sees the glory of that one. وَهُوَ مَعَكُمْ أَيْنَمَا كُنْتُمْ. Another one. His hands have been tied. His feet have been tied. And he has been put into the cup of the catapult. And they stoked a fire and they made this fire so big and so huge that they can't even go near it. They can't even go near this fire. So they have to use siege machinery. They have to put him into a catapult, a siege machinery, to throw him into this fire. And he's sitting there, Khalilullah. Jibreel alayhi salam comes and he says, oh Nabi of Allah, oh Khalil of Allah, tell me, what can I do for you? To kya bola? Bola yaar, isi ki to mehnat hai. What did he say? He said, ask you, what can you do for me? What do you think I've been working on all my life? What can you do for me? So Jibreel alayhi salam goes to Allah Jalla wa Ala. And of course Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is aware of everything. And he says, Ya Rab, Ya Rab, your Nabi is about to be burnt. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, now go to him and tell him I sent you. And tell him I am asking, what do you want? Ajib Allah ki shaan hai. Jibreel comes again. Ya Khalilullah, Ya Ibrahim, Ya Nabi Allah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent me now. I didn't come on my own. Allah sent me now. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants to know, what do you want? وَهُوَ مَعَكُمْ أَيْنَمَا كُنْتُمْ. You know what he says? He says, Allah does not need to ask. Yeah, this is a different level, eh? It's a different level. ये तो अल्लाह की मर्जी से इस हद तक इत्तेफाक है कि बंदा मांगता भी नहीं है. कहला जो तू चाह, तू जलाना चाह तो जल जाएंगे, नो प्रॉब्लम. तू बचाना चाह तो तू बचाने वाला है. This is reaching a level of ma'iyat of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala where the slave does not even ask anymore. And he says, oh Allah, I am ready. Whatever you want is what I want. This is the level of the Hadith Qudsi, which you will hear. It's part of your reading material and the things that some of the things which Shaykh Muhammad will teach you, inshallah. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, I become the hand by which he holds. My slave comes so close to me. By what? By his nawafil. The fard is the doorway, my brothers and sisters. Don't think you did a great thing or I did a great thing by reading the fard. The fard salah is the gateway. You don't read the fard, you are out of Islam. You leave the fard, you are out of Islam. But to get close to Allah, we have to improve our ibadat. So Ibrahim alayhi salam says, my Rabb does not need to ask. Tabhi socho, dekho Allah ne kya kiya. See what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not say to Jibreel, all right, now go put out the fire. No, he did not say to Mikael, open the skies, drain down a flood on this fire. No. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, agar mera banda mujhse mangta hai, to hum waise bagair, wo bagair, without any means, without any, bagair kisi waaste ke humse manga, raast humse manga, hum usko raast denge. So what does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala do? Ya nar, kuni bardan wa salaman ala Ibrahim. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala directly addresses the fire. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, O fire, become cold and become a source of protection. Wa salaman, a source of peace, a source of protection for Ibrahim. Reflect on the Quran. Why did Allah not put out the fire? Think about this. Because if Allah had put out the fire, it would have given the impression that the fire can actually cause harm. The fire can cause harm, therefore we have to put out the fire. But my Rabb wanted to tell you and me, the fire can do nothing. Illa masha Allah. La nafi wa la dharra illa Allah. So Allah kept the fire going and said, this fire cannot harm unless the Rabb of the fire commands it to harm. And the same fire which will burn anything and everything else cannot touch a hair on the skin of Ibrahim, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered this fire. You will not harm my slave. You will not harm my Khalil. The Khalil asked. The Khalil was ready for anything which his Rabb wanted. My purpose in life is to please you. Khalas. What do you want? Whatever you want. What can I give you? Whatever you like. وَهُوَ مَعَكُمْ أَيْنَ مَا كُنْتُمْ نَمْعِيَّةَ وَاللَّهِ. The awareness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala being with us. And then we come to the last of them and the best of them. And they are going, the two of them. And there is a bounty on the head of 100 camels each. And every sword in Arabia is raised against them. And they have taken refuge in a cave. And when they are in this cave, his companion says to him, he says, Ya Rasulullah, if they look down, I can see their feet at the mouth of the cave. Ya Rasulullah, if they look down, they will see us. And what does his companion say? وَإِذْ قَالَ لِسَاحِبِهِ لَا تَحْزَنْ إِنَّ اللَّهَ مَعَانَا. He says, don't be afraid. Don't be afraid. Allah is with us. How can they look down when whether to look or not is in the hand of their Rabb? How can they look down and see anything when the power of sight is controlled by their Rabb? How can their neck even bend down for them to look when the neck is controlled by their Rabb? وَهُوَ مَعْكُمْ أَيْنَمَا كُنْتُمْ. Complete sense of peace. Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu anhu, during his Khilafah, the early part of his Khilafah, when there was Ridda all around Arabia, all over Arabia, when the tribes were rebelling and they were committing irtidad and they were refusing to pay zakat, and there was great danger of Medina being attacked and the light of Islam being wiped out forever. And the Sahaba were obviously, everyone was very worried. And Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu anhu had absolutely no worry. Absolutely no worry. So one day somebody asked him, they asked him, Ya Khalifatu Rasulullah, because the term Amirul Mumineen started from Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu. Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu anhu was Khalifatu Rasulullah. So he said, Ya Khalifatu Rasulullah, how is it that you are not afraid? How is it that you have no anxiety? He said, there was a day when I had anxiety. And he said, from that day, I have never had anxiety again. لا تحزن إن الله معنا لما يطب الله. Brothers and sisters, I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give us the awareness of His presence. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give us the awareness of His mahiyat. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to use these days that we are here to open our hearts to Him, to open our hearts to His glory and majesty, to open our hearts to the fact that He is with us wherever we are. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to wipe our hearts clean of all anxieties, completely and totally. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to accept every dua that we ask. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give us with khair, because He knows what is good and what is not good. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to accept every dua of ours and to give us that which He knows is good for us. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make it possible for us to live this life from this minute onwards only and only to please Him. No other consideration whatsoever. We live this life only and only to please Allah. Ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to open the doors of His rahmah and of His barak in your lives and to make you among His closest awliya. Ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because He is the one who decides who is the wali. And ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make you all among His awliya. And ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to accept all your du'as. And ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, think of that which you consider to be completely impossible and ask Allah. Specifically, think of something which you consider to be completely impossible according to you and ask Allah for that. And ask Allah and say to Allah, oh Allah, give it because you can give it. No other reason. Give it because you can give it. Give it to show your khudrat. Give it to show your power in my life. Ask Allah. And ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give you all of those things with khair, inshallah. Wa sallallahu ala nabiyil kareem wa ala alihi wa ashabihi ajmain bi rahmatika ya arhamar rahimin. Those of you who are wondering, how is it I'm asking all of these du'as for you and I'm not asking for myself, you know why? Because I'm a very selfish person. I'm very selfish. I remember the hadith of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He said, when you make a du'a for your brother, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala appoints an angel to make the same du'a for you. And that's the reason why I'm making all of these du'as for you. Because all those du'as come to me. Jazakum Allah khair wa salamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Assalamu alaykum, brothers. Just in terms of the program now, we're going to break for 15 minutes, right? We can just have a cup of tea, whatever. And then we're going to meet in the conference center. Conference center is, as you exit this door, down towards the bottom of the grass, then left, you'll come to conference center. You can bring your tea there. Inshallah, tomorrow we'll provide the tea. Plus now. 25 plus now. 25 plus now. 25 plus now. 25 plus now.